Greetings, everyone. My name is Stefan Sorger. I'm an instructor for data analytics and other courses. I'll be taking you through an introduction to cluster analysis using R. We've made every effort to ensure accuracy and relevancy of the content. Nevertheless, we cannot control how the information is being used, so we assume no liability for the use of this content. This video shows basic methods for combining data records into groups or clusters using the R programming language. We discuss the purpose of cluster analysis and the advantages and disadvantages of different methods. We then demonstrate the process using actual data, executing cluster analysis using the popular Hclust function in R. We conclude the video with showing how to create cluster plots called dendograms, which show how the data is arranged into groups. The purpose of cluster analysis is to group data into different clusters or segments. Our goal is to create order out of chaos, similar to grouping a random stack of magazines into logical clusters. Often we don't know how to group the data, or we are open to new grouping methods. For that reason, we typically do not have a dependent variable as we would in, for example, regression analysis. We study the characteristics of the data based on the input variables to understand how to sort the data into different groups or clusters. Two popular methods for cluster analysis include hierarchical methods, such as the Hclust function in R, and non-hierarchical methods, such as the k-means function in R. In hierarchical clustering, we begin with a number of clusters and merge them to form a hierarchical cluster structure, which suggests a logical grouping. In non-hierarchical clustering, we tell R how many groups to expect, and then R attempts to form clusters based on that number of groupings. We will focus on the Hclust function in this video, which applies hierarchical agglomerative clustering to form groups. Cluster analysis techniques boast several advantages. First, cluster analysis is a versatile tool, useful for a wide range of applications, such as market segmentation. Second, we can gain insight into the different resulting clusters, such as how to market to a particular segment. And third, cluster analysis methods include graphical outputs that can visually display the clusters. Of course, we also face some disadvantages. Hierarchical clustering methods can be sensitive to outliers and missing data. And k-means clustering methods require us to choose the number of clusters before we start. That can be a problem because one of the primary functions of cluster analysis is to tell us what clusters there are in the data. For our example dataset, we selected the wine dataset from the UC Irvine Machine Learning Repository. The stated purpose of the dataset is to identify membership of wine and one of three cultivars or varieties, all within the same region of Italy, based on 13 chemical constituents. The 13 variables are shown here and include alcohol content, malic acid content, and so forth. The data also includes the cultivar, or CV, where the data was sourced, including CV1, CV2, and CV3. The dataset is in comma-separated values, or CSV, format, as shown in the image. Note that the data does not include a header row, which is the first row at the top of the dataset with the descriptive names for the variables. The data includes 178 samples with 13 continuous numerical variables and one categorical variable, namely the cultivar that identifies the variety, CV1, CV2, and CV3. We start by reading in the CSV data using the read.csv function in R. We state that the header equals false because the data does not include a header row. To make the data easier to work with, we add column names to each of the variables using the callNames function in R. The variable names include the names of the 13 chemical constituents given to us, as well as the variable which contains the cultivar from which the sample was taken, which we call CV. To get syntax and usage for all R functions in this video, we will use the R manual. But including the C variable is kind of cheating because it could suggest to R how to cluster the data. Therefore, we will remove the CV data by nulling out the CV values. To null them out, we create a new data frame called wine_no_cv.df and set the CV values to null. We ask R to list out the head or top of the data frame using the head function. In this case, we will list out the first three rows by entering 3 for the number of rows. The slide shows the before and after. The top head shows the original data frame, wine_cv.df, with the CV data intact. The bottom head shows the revised data set, wine_no_cv.df, with the CV data nulled out. With the data read in, we go to the next step, which is to normalize it. The variables in the data have different scales, which could skew the algorithms. For example, the maximum value for proline, or 1680, is much larger than that for non-flavonoid, or 0.66, which could cause R to emphasize proline when clustering the data. We can scale the data to normalize it using the scale function in R. By normalizing the data, we are subtracting the mean of the variable from the data and then dividing that amount by the standard deviation. We can apply the scale function to the data using the sApply function. When we do so and print out the head of the data, we can verify that the data has been rescaled. R includes several functions useful in hierarchical clustering. The first is Hclust, which executes hierarchical clustering, as the name suggests. The function groups similar data points that are near each other into clusters. The Hclust function offers several different clustering methods. We recommend using the ward.d2 method, not the ward method, because the ward.d2 method more faithfully captures the actual clustering algorithm created by ward. To execute the Hclust function, we will need to know the distance between the data points. We can compute the distance using the dist function. The dist function offers several different methods to calculate distance. In general, we favor the use of the Euclidean method unless there's a compelling reason to apply a different method. In the Euclidean method, distances are measured using a straight line from one point to the other. To execute hierarchical clustering in R, we first compute the distance using the dist function. Here you can see that we calculate the distance using the Euclidean method and place the result in a data frame we call wine_no_cv_dist.df. We then enter that data frame into the hclust function and use the ward.d2 method to calculate the clusters. We assign the results to a data frame we call wine_no_cv_clust.df. We plot out the results. Plots of hierarchical clusters are called dendograms. The dendograms show a reverse tree-like structure with branches at the bottom and the trunk at the top. At the bottom of the diagram, we see the individual data points. As we progress up the diagram, we see the data being agglomerated or grouped into clusters. In general, we want to select the number of clusters by drawing a horizontal line through the longest vertical section of the dendrogram. In our case, we've drawn a horizontal line which segments the data into 3 clear clusters. Let's examine a typical cluster, such as the one on the lower left with the box around it. This image shows an enlargement of one of the clusters. We can see that the cluster is made up of many data points clustered together hierarchically. For example, we can see that the data records 159 and 160 are next to each other at the bottom. We ask R to list out the data from the original data frame winecv.df for records 159 and 160. Doing so shows us two things. First, we see that the cultivar, or CV, for both is identical. The hclust function has thus successfully matched the grouping of cultivars in the original wine dataset. Second, we see that the chemical constituents are similar for each data record, which further reinforces the function's ability to group similar data into clusters. To make the clusters more clear, we can invoke the rect.hclust function. The function cuts the tree into the number of clusters you specify and draws boxes around each cluster. In our case, we've drawn red boxes around our three clusters. Dendograms are useful in industry because they clearly show the structure of the data. In some cases, one can decide to group the data into different numbers of clusters depending on the structure of the dendogram. For example, if we extended our original horizontal line farther down the dendogram, we could assign the data into more clusters, thus giving us more granularity for segmentation. In this video, we discuss the purpose of cluster analysis, as well as advantages and disadvantages of different methods. We demonstrated the technique using sample data in a typical cluster analysis problem. We concluded the video by showing how to create cluster plots called dendograms, which show how the data is arranged into groups. Thank you for watching. If you found this video helpful, please submit to the channel.